My name is Dr. Sarah Sammons, and I'm a breast medical oncologist and the associate director of the Embrace Metastatic Breast Cancer Program at Dana-Farber. This afternoon, I will be moderating the breakout session on triple negative metastatic breast cancer. During this breakout session, Dr. Garrido-Castro and Dr. Filipa Lynce, two renowned experts in the triple negative breast cancer field, will discuss updates on the standard of care and novel therapies that are in development and are exciting for the treatment of triple negative metastatic breast cancer. After their presentations, I will then moderate a question and answer session with the two of them to try to answer some burning questions that you might have about the disease. Please be sure to add your questions to the queue by clicking on the Q&A button on the bottom of your screen and typing in your questions. Please be aware that if you put your questions into the chat, we might miss them, so please put them into the Q&A. Next slide. It is now my pleasure to introduce you to Dr. Garrido-Castro. She is a wonderful breast medical oncologist at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute and an assistant professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School. Since joining the Breast Oncology Center at Dana-Farber in 2016, she has established an active clinical practice and research efforts focused on the development of novel therapies to improve outcomes in patients with breast cancer. And she is co-director of the Triple Negative Breast Cancer Working Group at Dana-Farber and leads many clinical trials studying immunotherapy and targeted therapies for patients with triple negative breast cancer. Thank you so much for joining us today, Dr. Garrido-Castro.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sammons, for that very kind introduction, and thank you all for joining today. Over the next 20 minutes or so, we're going to talk a bit about updates in the treatment of advanced triple negative breast cancer. Next slide, please. And we're specifically going to talk about some of the agents that have been approved over the past 5 to 7 years for the treatment of advanced triple negative breast cancer that have significantly improved outcomes for women and for patients living with this type of metastatic breast cancer. We know that the treatment of metastatic breast cancer is clearly shifting towards more individualized, personalized care, where we now sample, we do testing of tumor samples, biopsies, to try to identify specific markers within the tumor to help guide our selection of therapy. Now, over the past decade, there have been several new therapies that have been FDA approved for the treatment of advanced triple negative breast cancer. Many of those have overlapping indications, meaning that now we have different options to choose from, even at the same time point in the course of metastatic breast cancer. And so it has become important to understand how to best sequence also our available therapies. And there are multiple factors that should be taken into consideration when making decisions about treatment. Next slide, please. We know that some of these factors include weighing the potential benefits of each regimen, and that includes the impact on survival, how long patients live with metastatic triple negative breast cancer, achieving shrinkage of the tumor, but also not only living longer, but the quality of life with metastatic breast cancer. Next, please. We also know that we need to weigh the potential risks of therapy. In essence, the side effects of each treatment option, patient time and resources as well, in addition to some of the financial toxicity that these newer agents carry. Next. And all of this while taking into consideration individual factors, like, for example, the burden of tumor, where there is evidence of tumor, medical history, are there past medical issues that may allow us to select one option versus another? And then also patient preference in terms of the scheduling, route of administration of these agents, and duration of therapy. Next. So how do we define triple negative breast cancer? When a breast cancer is first diagnosed in the biopsy, we look for specific markers, in particular, three markers. Two of those are the hormone receptors, the estrogen receptor and the progesterone receptor. And the third is a marker that is called HER2. And when all three of those markers are lacking in a tumor, as shown here on the far right, the column on the far right, that is what we call a triple, that is how we call a triple negative breast cancer. In essence, it's called by what it does not have. And approximately 10 to 15% of all breast cancers are classified as triple negative. Next. We now know that there are specific markers that we can look for in triple negative breast cancer that can identify potential treatment options for patients. So there have been many research efforts over the past years to try to identify something by which we can call triple negative positive four. And some of these markers include one that is called PD-L1 that identifies patients who are potential candidates who may benefit from immunotherapy in combination with chemotherapy. We also look for germline BRCA mutations, so an inherited predisposition to developing breast cancer with the presence of a BRCA1 or BRCA2 mutation. And this occurs in about 10% of patients diagnosed with metastatic triple-negative breast cancer. And this opens up another treatment option that is called a PARP inhibitor. And then also, we have now a new category within triple negative breast cancer called HER2 low. And we'll talk a little bit about the implications of HER2 low, how it is defined, and how it identifies patients who are potential candidates for treatment with trastuzumab deruxtecan. Next slide, please. And we'll start first by talking about immunotherapy. Next. So, how does immunotherapy work? We know that there are specific interactions between tumor cells and the immune cells in our body. And there's an interaction specifically called the PD-1 and PD-L1 interaction. And when this interaction occurs, it in essence turns off the immune system so that it can no longer recognize the cancer cells and attack the tumor. By administering treatment with a PD-1 or PD-L1 antibody, we break that interaction, therefore lifting the brakes off of the immune system so it can then recognize the cancer and attack the tumor. And there are many different PD-1 and PD-L1A antibodies that are currently FDA approved for treatment across different cancer types. And in particular, one that is approved for the treatment of triple negative breast cancer, which is called pembrolizumab. And pembrolizumab blocks PD-1 and is approved not only for advanced triple negative breast cancer, but most recently also for patients with early stage triple negative breast cancer. Next slide, please. And so the approval of pembrolizumab in combination with chemotherapy came from a study called the KEYNOTE-355 trial. This was a study that looked at the effectiveness of pembrolizumab in combination with chemotherapy compared to standard chemotherapy alone in patients with metastatic triple-negative breast cancer as the first-line treatment option for metastatic disease. And in this study, which was a large randomized phase three trial, this study showed that patients who had what is so-called PD-L1 positive tumors, a marker that we look for in a tumor sample from a biopsy, that those patients derived benefit from the combination of chemotherapy and immunotherapy. And about 40% of patients with triple-negative breast cancer have, in fact, PD-L1 positive tumors. And we know that these patients derived benefit from pembrolizumab and chemotherapy in that they remained longer on treatment while on study if they received the combination versus chemotherapy alone. And also, patients who received this combination lived longer. And so, this led to the approval by the FDA of pembrolizumab for PD-L1 positive metastatic triple negative breast cancer. Next slide, please. We also have seen over the past decade the approval of two PARP inhibitors, which in essence are medications that interfere with the ability of the tumor cells to repair DNA and therefore leading to death of the tumor cells. And these PARP inhibitors, olaparib and talazoparib, are approved for patients who have germline BRCA one or two mutations and have metastatic HER2 negative breast cancer, including triple negative breast cancer. And this approval came from these approvals came from two clinical trials, the Olympiad study on the left for olaparib and the Imbraca trial on the right for talazoparib. And these studies compared the PARP inhibitor to standard chemotherapy options in patients with germline BRCA1 or 2 mutations who had received up to two or three prior lines of chemotherapy. So in essence, up to a first, a second, third, or even beyond a line of therapy for metastatic triple negative disease. And this study, next slide, please, not only showed that the PARP inhibitors, that patients remained longer on treatment with a PARP inhibitor than with chemotherapy, but also improved quality of life, as assessed by surveys that were filled out by patients who participated on the trial, where patients maintained quality of life longer if they were on the PARP inhibitor compared to some of the standard chemotherapy options. Next slide, please. And now there have also been some emerging data to supporting the use of PARP inhibitors in other patients who, for example, carry a germline PALB2 mutation instead of a BRCA1 or 2 mutation, shown by higher rates of response in the tumor to PARP inhibition. And so now we consider use of olaparib even beyond patients who have germline BRCA1 or 2 mutations. Next slide, please. Now, a novel class of medications that has transformed the treatment landscape across all breast cancer subtypes over the past few years, but also including triple negative breast cancer, are a type of medications called antibody drug conjugates, or ADCs. So what is an ADC? An ADC, in essence, is a way of delivering chemotherapy in a targeted manner to cancer cells. ADCs, in fact, are a monoclonal antibody, and that antibody binds to a specific target that is present on the surface of tumor cells. And the antibody carries several molecules of very highly potent chemotherapy attached to it. And so, next slide, please. You can see that the antibody can bind to a target on the cancer cell, and then that gets internalized into the cancer cell, as you can see in number two. And then number three, the chemotherapy gets released into the cancer cell, where it can then have its anti-tumor effects. But also for some of the newer ADCs that are now approved, that chemotherapy can in fact exit the cancer cell, going through that membrane that recovers the that covers the tumor, and it can enter adjacent cancer cells that may not necessarily have that target on the surface of the cell. And that's the so-called bystander effect of antibody drug conjugates. Next slide, please. There are currently two antibody drug conjugates that are approved for the treatment of advanced triple negative breast cancer. On the left, trastuzumab deruxtecan, or TDXD, which is an ADC that binds to a target, HER2. And one might ask, why would you target HER2 in a HER2 negative breast cancer, such as triple negative breast cancer? And that is because there are some triple negative tumors that have some degree of HER2 on the surface of the tumor cells, not enough to be called HER2 positive, but these are now so-called HER2 low tumors. And we'll talk a little bit about the data for TDXD in patients with HER2 low advanced triple negative breast cancer. And then on the right, sacituzumab govitecan, or SASI for short, which is an antibody drug conjugate that targets TROP2. And most triple negative breast cancers have some degree of TROP2 on the surface of the tumor cells. And so we don't routinely look for TROP2 as a marker to identify potential candidates for sacituzumab govitecan, as it is a medication that can be used regardless of levels of TROP2 on the tumor. Next slide, please. So how do we define HER2 low? So when a biopsy is performed, in the pathology reports, HER2 is scored as 0, 1+, 2+, or 3+. And 3+ is considered positive. And those tumors that are 1+ or 2+, meaning that they have some degree of HER2 on the surface, but not enough to be called positive, and don't have amplification by another test that's called FISH. These tumors are what are called now HER2 low. And trastuzumab deruxtecan is an ADC that targets specifically HER2. Next slide, please. The approval of T-DXd came from the DESTINY-Breast04 trial, where patients who had advanced HER2 low breast cancer, who had received one or two prior chemotherapies before participating in the trial, either received T-DXd or standard chemotherapy as part of this study. And this trial demonstrated that patients who received T-DXd were on treatment for a longer period of time than those who received standard chemotherapy options. And also, these patients lived longer if they had received T-DXd. And so that led to the approval of T-DXd for patients with HER2 low metastatic breast cancer. Next slide, please. Similarly, sacituzumab govitecan was compared to chemotherapy physician's choice in a large phase III study called the ASCENT trial. And here, patients who had metastatic triple negative, who had also received prior chemotherapy for metastatic disease, so in essence, looking at a second line option or beyond, either received sacituzumab or chemotherapy. And on this study also, patients were on treatment longer if they received sacituzumab, and there was also an improvement in terms of life expectancy with sacituzumab compared to chemotherapy. And this led to the approval of sacituzumab for metastatic triple negative breast cancer. Next slide, please. We know that these ADCs are associated with side effects, and there are some differences that are important to note between T-DXd and sacituzumab govitecan. You can see here that there are differences in the rates of low blood cell counts. Next slide, please. Where we see higher rates of low neutrophil counts with sacituzumab govitecan. And in fact, this sometimes requires growth factor support with, for example, injections of Neupogen or Neulasta to keep the blood cell counts within range to be able to continue treatment. With T-DXd, we also see low platelet counts, which can increase the rates of bruising or bleeding. And so it is important to monitor for these counts as well. Next, please. There are also differences in the rates of nausea, vomiting, or diarrhea. And there are strategies that we can implement to try to mitigate side effects with both of these agents. And then finally, we do see hair loss with both of these medications, in addition to also mouth sores. And finally, with trastuzumab deruxtecan, there is the potential for inflammation of the lungs. And in some cases, this can be potentially serious and life-threatening. And therefore, it is very important that while on treatment with trastuzumab deruxtecan, that patients report any respiratory symptoms that may develop so that this can be promptly worked up. Next slide, please. So, how do we integrate all of this into how we think about treatment for metastatic triple-negative breast cancer? Next. So, our first-line approach depends on PD-L1 status, that marker for immunotherapy. And if PD-L1 is positive, then chemotherapy in combination with pembrolizumab is generally the preferred first approach. If PD-L1 is negative, we have standard chemotherapy options that are available in addition to PARP inhibitors like olaparib or talazoparib for patients who have BRCA mutations. Next, please. And after that first-line option, there are many different options that are available, including the ADCs, such as sacituzumab govitecan and trastuzumab deruxtecan for patients who have HER2-low metastatic triple-negative breast cancer, in addition to other chemotherapy options that can be used later on, and some also biomarker-specific targeted therapies. Next, please. But can we take this one step further? And can we see if these antibody-drug conjugates could be used earlier in the treatment of triple-negative breast cancer? And there are several trials that Dr. Lynce will talk about in more detail looking at TROP2 ADCs, such as sacituzumab govitecan, or a new TROP2 ADC called datopotamab deruxtecan, or Dato-DXd, compared to standard chemotherapy in patients with PD-L1 negative, triple negative breast cancer. Next slide, please. And also looking at these TROP2 ADCs in combination with immunotherapy compared to the current standard chemotherapy plus pembrolizumab approach in patients with PD-L1 positive tumors, and utilizing this approach as our first line therapy option. Next slide, please. Now, importantly, now that we have two antibody drug conjugates that are available for the treatment of triple negative breast cancer, and many others that are currently being studied in clinical trials, it has become very important to understand if there is a preferred initial antibody drug conjugate. So is there one that we should use first? And two, can we use them in sequence? So after one stops working, is it possible to use another? And will patients benefit from using them in sequence? And so to address these important questions, we are about to launch a study called the TRADE-DXd trial that is looking specifically at the sequence of a HER2-targeted antibody-drug conjugate, then followed by a TROP2-directed antibody-drug conjugate, or vice versa. Next slide, please. And to better understand what truly drives response to these therapies, and not just antibody drug conjugates, but other treatments such as immunotherapy and even standard chemotherapy approaches, it is important to be able to interrogate different types of samples, like tumor biopsies, blood samples, in addition to looking at clinical data, pre and post treatment, so that we can understand why and how these treatments work well when they do, and why they don't when tumors grow quickly on these therapies, and what can we do to improve outcomes. And with that idea, we launched several years ago a triple negative breast cancer registry, which is an effort to collect this type of information, including samples, blood samples, tumor samples, clinical information, and also patient-reported outcomes through surveys from time of initial diagnosis and with follow-up throughout the course of treatment. Next slide, please. This is actually an effort that is being conducted across different centers in the New England area, and we're branching out to sites across the US, including in Atlanta and others soon to come. And we are hoping here to collect, we are collecting tissue and blood and in microbiome samples to be able to look at changes pre and post treatment and associate that with clinical information. And also surveys that are filled out by patients focused on specific areas of unmet need. Next slide, please. There are close to 400 patients who have generously contributed to the triple negative breast cancer registry. So thank you. And our target goal is 500. We hope to be able to present also results of all of the research that is ongoing now with the data and samples that have been collected so far. Next slide, please. So here are our key takeaway messages. For immunotherapy, we know that pembrolizumab is currently approved with chemotherapy as a first-line treatment option for patients with PD-L1 positive, triple negative metastatic breast cancer. We also have PARP inhibitors that are available for patients who carry germline BRCA1 or BRCA2 mutations. And there are now two antibody drug conjugates that are approved as second line options and beyond for metastatic triple negative breast cancer, sacituzumab govitecan and trastuzumab deruxtecan, but there are many new ADCs, immunotherapies, and other targeted approaches that are in development that Dr. Lynce will talk about a bit more in a minute. And ultimately, understanding the mechanisms behind how these treatments work will be key to help inform our subsequent treatment efforts and strategies, including how can we best combine agents, how can we best sequence them, and duration of therapies as well. So with that, thank you for your attention, and I'll pass it back over to Dr. Sammons and Dr. Lynce.
Thank you so much, Dr. Garrido-Castro. It's incredibly helpful to learn these updates for our patients that are facing triple negative breast cancer. And it is now my pleasure to introduce Dr. Filipa Lynce. She is a breast medical oncologist and clinical investigator in the Breast Oncology Center at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. She is also director of the Inflammatory Breast Cancer Program at Dana-Farber and an assistant professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School. Her research focuses on inflammatory breast cancer, triple negative breast cancer, BRCA-associated breast cancers, and novel therapies in the treatment of breast cancer. And thank you for joining us here this afternoon, Dr. Lynce, to talk about new and exciting strategies.
Thank you very much. I am delighted to be here today with you all, and thank you for the invitation to be here. Next slide, please. And these are my disclosures. Next slide. So this is a topic that it's dear to my heart. This cartoon highlights some of the agents and targets that are currently being investigated in triple negative breast cancer. And I think that it's encouraging, in particular in a for a disease that we need to do better. It's encouraging to see that there's a number of promising therapies that are on the horizon, including improved versions of already existing drugs or novel agents. And I plan to show some of that work being done. I plan to show you just a few examples today. Next slide. So I'll just go over one by one the categories that are in this cartoon, although I'll not touch on all of them. We'll talk about PARP inhibitors later today. So I'll skip that one for now. In terms, next slide, please. The androgen receptor is being investigated in triple negative breast cancer, which, until now we always associate with prostate cancer. And there is a study with enzalutamide that it's an androgen receptor antagonist that will open in the near future here at Dana-Farber. So very excited to see what might be that role for a selected number of patients with triple negative breast cancer. Next slide. Some of you might remember that the role of angiogenesis or the vasculature, the blood vessels, is very important in triple negative. We used to have a drug approved in triple negative called bevacizumab or Avastin that since then lost FDA approval, but we are seeing novel agents that are being focused again on the role of these blood vessels in triple negative breast cancer. Next slide. Now, here in this cartoon, you see the role of PI3 kinase and AKT inhibitors. So recently we learned about a negative study looking at capivasertib. Capivasertib is a drug that it's approved for the treatment of ER-positive breast cancer, but it seems at least a study that looked at the role of this drug in triple negative in combination with chemo was negative. So it's unclear where targeting this pathway will go in triple negative breast cancer. So we will not talk about it today. Next slide. And then finally, a very important part of the work that is being done in triple negative, and Dr. Garrido-Castro showed you some of the important work done here in terms of antibody drug conjugates, other type of immunotherapies beyond the immune checkpoint blockades or in combination with other agents. Next slide. So these are the three that I'll focus on for the next 10 minutes or 15 minutes. We'll look at a new antibody drug conjugate that Dr. Garrido-Castro already alluded to. We'll talk about what are PARP1 selective inhibitors, which are a little bit different from the olaparib and talazoparib that you heard about it just a few minutes ago. And then we'll briefly touch on this new class of drugs that we breast cancer doctors and breast cancer patients are not so familiarized with, but other diseases are, which are bispecific antibodies. Next slide, please. So this cartoon, I just wanted to show you how many antibody drug conjugates are currently in development. Here, you don't have the name of them, But you have the multiple different companies that are developing antibody drug conjugates. At the center, you can see some of the different diseases that either currently have already approved antibody drug conjugates or have, actually, all of them have already approved. This is what you see on the light green. And then in the different layers of blue, you see the different phases of antibody drug conjugates in development. So this is exciting, meaning that there is hope that in the years to come, we'll see more approvals of antibody drug conjugates, and breast cancer should not be an exception. Next slide, please. So you saw these slides presented to you a few minutes ago showing two of the three antibody drug conjugates that are currently approved in triple negative breast cancer. Next slide. And I wanted to talk to you about Dato-DXd or Dato-Deruxtecan. So Dato-DXd, as we commonly call it, or Dato, is another antibody that it's close, or it's the one that it's further advanced in development in breast cancer that has not received an approval yet. And I just wanted to show you, I put it here in these slides below trastuzumab deruxtecan and sacituzumab govitecan on purpose, because the Dato-DXd has the same payloads, meaning the chemotherapy, as T-DXd, and it's easy. It's the DXd deruxtecan that it's the what is being delivered to the cancer cells. But then the antibody, what really brings this payload to the cancer cells, is a TROP2, just like sacituzumab govitecan. So it's a little bit a mixture of both, but it's important for us to have that in mind when we think about who are the best patients to receive this medication. Next slide, please. So I wanted to show you here results that have now been presented of Begonia. Begonia is a trial that we had here open at Dana-Farber, a phase 1b/2 study. It's more of a platform where we were able to evaluate durvalumab, that it's a anti-PD-L1 in combination with novel agents for patients that were initially diagnosed with triple negative breast cancer, with metastatic triple negative breast cancer. And I'll just guide you very quickly here through the results. The lines that are negative, so all the ones, the majority of the lines or columns that you see on this slide, that's a good thing. Each of those columns correspond to a patient, and all of those that go down means that there was a response when, or that there was a shrinkage in the tumor or stabilization when treated in this study with Dato-DXd and durvalumab. So we know that this combination is potent, is effective, and what we learned from this study as well was that there were responses regardless of PD-L1 expression. So we are starting to see how checkpoint inhibitors might be used even for tumors that are PD-L1 negative. Next slide, please. So I'll tell you now about two large phase 3 trials that, depending on the results, this might lead to the approval of Dato-DXd for patients with metastatic triple negative breast cancer. So this trial, TROPION-Breast02, is for patients that are not candidates to PD-L1 inhibition. So patients that are not candidates for the pembrolizumab, as it is currently approved. And here patients are randomized. So we flip a coin and half of the patients receive Dato-DXd and half of the patients receive investigator's choice of chemotherapy. So this study is enrolling. The next trial that it's illustrated in the next slide, please, is TROPION-Breast05. So it's a little bit the sister trial of TROPION-Breast02 in the way that this is for patients that have PD-L1 positive triple negative breast cancer. We learned from Dr. Garrido-Castro presentation that this is an important separation or cutoff or criteria to have when it comes to make our recommendations in terms of treatments. And in this trial, patients that have PD-L1 positive metastatic breast cancer, they could go on this study and they either receive Dato-DXd with durvalumab, so the same combination that I showed you in the Begonia study, or investigations of investigator's choice of chemotherapy with pembro, that we can say that it's the current standard of care, or Dato-DXd alone. So asking the question of how much what we saw in the study of Begonia was driven by Dato-DXd, this novel antibody drug conjugate, or actually it was the combination. So I suspect that we'll see more about these agents in the next few years, and hopefully an approval as well for the treatment of triple negative breast cancer. And of course, there are other ways to participate or to receive already these agents through clinical trials, and Dr. Garrido-Castro showed you other trials as well. Next slide, please. So next I'm going to talk to you about PARP1 selective inhibitors. Next slide, please. This is a cartoon that highlights the what is different about PARP1 selective inhibitors when compared to the PARP1 inhibitors in general that you heard about it, olaparib and talazoparib. So those medications, they inhibit both PARP1 and PARP2. Now, what seems to drive the efficacy or the activity of these agents seems to be mainly PARP1, and PARP2 actually seems to be, or we suspect that it's related to some of the toxicity seen with these agents, in particular with the anemia, the neutropenia, the drop in the blood counts that you can experience when you are being treated with olaparib or talazoparib. So in theory, PARP1 selective inhibitors will be less toxic and potentially more effective if, because of the lack of toxicities, you can, or the lack or less side effects, you can actually deliver a higher dose of the drug to the tumor cells. Next slide, please. So PETRA is a trial that we currently have open here at Dana-Farber. FIH means it's a first-in-human study looking at saruparib, that is a PARP1 selective inhibitor. There are others in development, but this is the one that is further along and already has a name. As you can see here in the first arm, or the part A of this study, these agents was evaluated, this medicine was evaluated alone without combining with other agents. And this was given for patients that had a BRCA1, BRCA2, PALB2, RAD51C or D mutations. And was focused on patients with breast, ovarian, pancreatic, or prostate cancer. Next slide, please. These are the results just for patients with breast cancer that was presented earlier this year. I think, again, what each column represents a patient, you can see that the majority went down. That is a good thing. Next slide. And I think that here the big challenge, I'll tell you what is the big challenge, but this slide just shows you that there might be. So if we combine a TOPO1 inhibitor with a PARP1 inhibitor, we might actually see these drugs not only working better because you are giving two at the same time, but actually doing a synergistic work. So meaning that they work even better than given than just the results of one and the other separately. So this might be the way as well of, for example, moving these drugs, the PARP inhibitors, but in particular the PARP1 selective inhibitors, to patients with triple negative breast cancer beyond those that have a BRCA1 or BRCA2 mutation. So we saw antibody drug conjugates that have that the chemotherapy that is being delivered is a TOPO1. So if we can combine these agents with PARP1 inhibitors, we might see efficacy even for patients that do not have a BRCA1 or BRCA2 mutations. We currently have two studies that are looking at this combination here open at Dana-Farber, and I am really excited with this novel combination. I think that this might be a way of moving forwards and being able to offer these agents to more patients. Next slide, please. So for the next few slides, I just wanted next last minutes, I just wanted to tell you about bispecific antibodies. Next slide, please. So this is a, I'm sorry, the prior slide. This is a new concept, or a relatively new concept for us here in the breast cancer world. This cartoon illustrates what is a bispecific antibody. So the typical antibodies that we that we talk about either as drugs or naturally occurring in our system, they only target one antigen, so they connect to one target only. But the bispecific antibodies, and you can already think about it because of the bi part of the word, is an antibody that can simultaneously bind to two different types of antigens, so two different targets, or two different portions of the same antigen, hopefully triggering a stronger response against the cancer cells, because the antibodies that they will target, the antigens that they will target, are with a mission on purpose to try to attack the cancer cells. So next slide. So I'm just going to give you here an example, rilvegostomig. This is a bispecific antibody that is against PD-1, and we know that this is important in triple-negative breast cancer, but also against TIGIT. So TIGIT is an immune receptor, so another way of attacking or not attacking or working with the immune system to fight breast cancer. And we know that TIGIT has an important role in suppressing the activation of T cells, and there has been studies showing that TIGIT is up in breast cancer cells. Next slide, please. So here I just wanted to show you a study that was conducted and presented activity. This one in a non-small cell lung cancer. They saw results as well, or some evidence of results on some patients that had PD-L1 negative tumors or that had received immunotherapy before. So not as stronger those that were naive, but more to investigate about whether we can increase the number of patients that might respond to immunotherapy. And we are going to see studies coming up in breast cancer, but with these bispecific antibody, but with other bispecific antibodies as well. So stay tuned. Next slide. So just wanted to summarize here the key takeaways from this presentation. Novel antibody drug conjugates with different payloads and targets are currently under development. PARP1 selective inhibitors may have a role in combination with other agents. And as this moves forward, this might be a way of offering PARP1 inhibitors to patients beyond those that have a BRCA mutation. And bispecific antibodies are emerging as a new strategy in the treatment of breast cancer. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Lynce. That was fantastic. And now I'll invite Dr. Garrido-Castro back for the Q&A. We have quite a shy crowd today. I don't see anything in the Q&A, so please, if you have any questions at all, there's, no question too small to ask us. We're here. We're happy to answer them. Since I don't have anything in the Q&A, we did have a couple of questions from patients prior to joining that they sent in, so I'll start with those. And either one of you could take this, and I could probably help a little bit. How common are brain metastasis in triple-negative breast cancer, and how do you think about treating them? Either one, you want to take them?
Go first, Filipa, or happy to.
So, actually, for the number, for the precise number, I'll have you, Dr. Sammons, answer. But I would say, and I don't know, can you see me?
We can see you.
You
Yeah,
can.
and I will say about
Perfect.
a third of patients with metastatic triple-negative breast cancer will develop brain metastasis. And so it's really important to let your doctor know you're having any sight, new headaches, vision changes, anything like that.
Great. But what I wanted to say from a, systemic standpoint, and for many of you that might be familiar with this problem as well in HER2-positive breast cancer, but opposite to HER2-positive, where we have seen wonderful approvals of agents that really are very effective in the treatment of brain metastases. We haven't seen that yet in triple negative breast cancer. So we tend to think about the way that we think. Is there just progression in the brain, and can we continue with the same agents and work with our wonderful radiation oncologists that look at the brain and see what is the way, or sometimes with surgery, that we can treat the brain disease while continuing the same systemic therapy, or if there is progression elsewhere and we need to switch the systemic therapy. But I would say that we are not so hopeful that with the current agents that we have, that we can take care of all the disease in the brain, opposite to HER2 positive, where we have seen some fantastic results in the last few years.
Yeah, I think that's right. I think local therapies play a very important role, like radiation and sometimes for a single lesion surgery. But we have a long way to go. We do have some clinical trials at Dana-Farber for triple negative brain metastasis. One specifically that we're excited about is looking at datopotamab deruxtecan in triple negative brain metastasis. Okay, the
That's right. And
next.
I did not, you are very right. And I talked about that our way to get the access to Dato-DXd before it is approved right now is through clinical trials. I mentioned some of them, but I did not mention that Dr. Sammons mentioned that is a very good one. And actually, Dr. Sammons, if you don't mind, just to piggyback on a question that I saw here on the chat. Dr. Garrido-Castro, you have been very involved as well with the development of clinical trials with Dato-DXd. When do you think, I know that the two studies that I showed that are currently enrolling, when do you have a timeline? When do you think that we can expect the approval of Dato-DXd in triple negative breast cancer?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I think first we need to see the results from these clinical trials, and we do anticipate that both for Dato-DXd and also for sacituzumab govitecan, we may see some of the results from the first line metastatic triple negative breast cancer trials in the near future, potentially within the next year. And depending on the results of these clinical trials, if they do in fact show that the TROP2 ADCs perform better than standard chemotherapy options for in the first line setting, then that could potentially lead to approval of these agents. I also see here some questions related to Dato-DXd in the chat, and a very important question about that's essentially asking if Dato-DXd has the same chemotherapy payload as T-DXd, does this mean it is in an additional line of treatment for triple negative breast cancer if someone has already had T-DXd? And this specifically is one of the questions we're trying to address with the TRAID-DXd trial that I mentioned earlier, where we're trying to see what is the effectiveness of these ADCs when you give them in sequence. And so, in particular, TRAID-DXd is addressing the question of if you switch the target of the antibody drug conjugate from HER2 with T-DXd to TROP2 with Dato-DXd or vice versa, do we see activity with both agents? In addition to this important question comes then another, which is what if we switched the payload of the antibody drug conjugate? And there are many new antibody drug conjugates that are currently being developed with different mechanisms than the chemotherapy payload of the DXd ADCs or of sacituzumab govitecan. And so many studies needed to actually address this question. But ultimately, if you've received trastuzumab deruxtecan or sacituzumab govitecan, and the tumor has grown on that therapy, we consider that one line of therapy and tend to switch to another treatment option. And I think we need to figure out what are the best treatment options if a tumor does grow while on one of these antibody drug conjugates.
Yeah. And even if you switched from one antibody drug conjugate like T-DXd to Dato-DXd, it is considered another line of therapy because it is a different drug and another target, to answer one of the questions in the chat. I have a lot of questions about targeting low levels of HER2 in triple negative breast cancer. How do you know, Dr. Garrido-Castro, how do you know if your tumor is HER2 low? How do you know if you might be a candidate for in HER2, and when would you think about using that?
Yes. Great question. So HER2 low is currently defined by a test called immunohistochemistry. So we look at this in a sample, either a tumor biopsy or a sample that was collected at the time of surgery. And on the pathology reports, we'll see HER2 by immunohistochemistry scored from 0 to 3+. We know that 3+ tumors are positive, and those that are 1+ or 2+, and don't have what's called amplification by a second test that's done called FISH, those are tumors that are HER2 low. So 1+ or 2+ that are not HER2 amplified. And that is the current definition of HER2 low breast cancer. And about 40% of all triple negative breast cancers are HER2 low.
And this is a really hard question, but if we, have the option of targeting HER2 or TROP2, do you have a preference? Does it depend on the patient? How do you think about that?
That is also a very good question. And I think it remains largely unanswered. Now, in triple negative breast cancer, the data that we have so far are more robust for the TROP2 ADCs. And when I say more robust, I mean that there was a clinical, a large clinical trial, the ASCENT study, that was conducted specifically for metastatic triple negative breast cancer. And that's the study that showed that sacituzumab govitecan improves outcomes compared to chemotherapy. The approval for T-DXd, which targets HER2, came from the DESTINY-Breast04 study, but that was a trial that enrolled mostly hormone receptor positive, HER2 low breast cancer patients. And only about 10% on patients on that study had triple negative HER2 low tumors. So with that in mind, while T-DXd also improved outcomes compared to chemotherapy in that study, and both ADCs are reasonable options in the second line setting, we do tend to position the TROP2 ADC first because of the additional data that we have in a larger patient population with sacituzumab govitecan. And I think that's also reflected by now what we're seeing in terms of clinical trials that are trying to move these ADCs into an earlier line of therapy, and where Dr. Lynce has showed the studies that are looking at TROP2 ADCs in the first line setting. And that's also being taken a step further. And there are TROP2 ADCs that are now being studied for patients with early stage triple negative breast cancer as therapy before going to surgery or even after surgery, if there's residual tumor.
Great. I'm going to ask the question that we do see in the clinic, but more on the rare end. How common is it to have an estrogen positive primary breast cancer? So you had stage one, two, or three breast cancer, and it was estrogen positive. But then when you develop metastatic disease, it comes back and it's triple negative. How common is that? And do you treat that any differently than any other type of triple negative breast cancer patient?
I can take that one. So it's not the most common, but it's not that rare. And that's one of the reasons why you always talk to patients about repeating doing a biopsy when we suspect that there is metastatic disease. Because, I think that is estimated to be about or around 10%, at least in old series, might be higher now. But it's important so that you know you are treating what the most current biopsy shows and not the initial tumor in case the characteristics have changed. And that happens from ER positive to triple negative, but as we know, that can happen in terms of HER2 status as well. So it's really important to know what you are dealing with. Sometimes I do that as well, and we discuss repeating biopsies, even on someone that initially presents with metastatic ER positive, HER2 negative disease, and you start seeing that it's starting not to respond to endocrine therapies, or there is a part of the tumor that it's no longer respond, a part of the tumor that is responding to your endocrine therapy, and then there's, for example, disease in the liver that is progressing. You might want to repeat the biopsy as well, because after that time, the way that I would change, Dr. Sammons, to answer your question is that I would not use endocrine-based approaches, and I would favor either chemotherapy or antibody drug conjugates that have shown to work both in triple negative and ER positive breast cancer. So that If there is a component of triple negative, then there is a safer approach, I would say.
Right. So I can't, really talk specifically about, specific patient cases. So I'm going to generalize this question a little bit. But if you have a patient that has had progression on immunotherapy, either in the first line metastatic setting or they had immunotherapy for early stage triple negative breast cancer, do you ever re-challenge them with immunotherapy again? And do you think that might have efficacy?
I can take that one if okay with you, Dr. Garrido-Castro. I was seeing that question and I was waiting to address. Just, we were some of the slides that I showed you with some of the clinical trials, they can actually offer opportunities for patients that either have PD-L1 negative disease or that had immunotherapy in the past to be rechallenged again. Might not be the same checkpoint inhibitors that we that are currently approved, but other types of immunotherapy or different agents, or in combination with other agents that might potentially make a tumor or turn a tumor start responding to immunotherapy if it stopped responding before. So, for example, I'm just giving an example of a trial that will open soon for triple negative breast cancer, where it patients with triple negative breast cancer and metastatic disease would receive two types. They would receive chemotherapy, one type of chemotherapy with a checkpoint inhibitor and with a targeted therapy that is thought to help and enhance the response to all these three agents, that is a WEE1 inhibitor. So I would say for that patient in particular, or for that case in particular that you are talking about, Dr. Sammons, that I would seek for clinical trials. And some of the clinical trials would exclude patients that have already experienced immunotherapy or that have progressed on immunotherapy, but others might allow in this type of combination strategies to see if a tumor starts responding again to an immunotherapy-containing regimen.
Great, thanks. And we're going to end on one last question, and I'll pose this to Dr. Garrido-Castro. What are some of the, most important side effects to look out for and think about in patients that are on antibody drug conjugates, let's say datopotamab deruxtecan and trastuzumab deruxtecan? What are some of the side effects to look out for and that you look out for in your patients?
Yes, this is a very important question. So some of the most common side effects that we see with the HER2 or TROP2-directed antibody drug conjugates that are currently available include low blood cell counts, which can make one more prone to infections. And so sometimes we need to manage these with injections such as Neupogen or Neulasta to help keep the white blood cell counts within range to be able to treat. To continue therapy. Any fever while on therapy is always important to alert your care team. One of the other frequent side effects that we see with some of these agents are GI side effects. So, for example, nausea or vomiting and diarrhea. And so, also discussing with the care team how best to manage these side effects with anti-nausea medications, anti-diarrheals, when to alert your care team as well, if you do develop any of these side effects is very important. Some of the less frequent side effects, but also very important to note that we're seeing with some of these emerging antibody drug conjugates, include, for example, with Dato-DXd, mucositis, so mouth sores, and there is a prophylactic mouthwash that can be used to try to prevent development of mouth sores. And also a dry eye, and can use eye drops to try to prevent also this side effect. Now, very importantly, with the DXd antibody drug conjugates and some of the other targeted therapies that are emerging, one key side effect that we need to be very mindful of, which we alluded to earlier, is interstitial lung disease or pneumonitis. In other words, inflammation of the lungs caused by the medication. And this can manifest in different ways, including shortness of breath, new cough, And it is very important to alert the care team when any respiratory symptoms develop while on these therapies. That will prompt additional workup of potential for ILD, for interstitial lung disease. Therapy generally needs to be interrupted while workup is being done. In many cases, steroids are utilized to treat as well. And because it is a potentially serious and life-threatening side effect, although not common, it is very important to be mindful of any respiratory symptoms that develop on these ADCs.
Right, like cough or shortness of breath and things like that. Well, that brings us to the end of this breakout session. I want to thank my friends, Dr. Garrido-Castro and Dr. Lynce, very much for joining us. And I want to thank all of the patients, advocates, family members that joined us this afternoon and for asking such thoughtful questions.